Hey guys, this is Vyom Joshi with Superior North. Welcome back to my channel. Last week, we reviewed J.M. Smucker's 10K annual report. We focused on the core business, looked at the risk factors, as well as the contingent liabilities associated with investing in the company. This week, we will be focusing our attention on its key ratios, doing a DCF, a discounted free cash flow analysis, as well as performing an expected rate of return calculation to figure out if you were to make an investment in J.M. Smucker's at the current valuations, what kind of return can we expect on that investment? So let's dive in and review J.M. Smucker Company.
Hey guys, let's start off by looking at the key ratios for J.M. Smucker. I'm on Morningstar for J.M. Smucker under key ratios. Looking at the financials, the first one that we have on the list is the revenue. All the numbers here are in millions of dollars. As we can see from 2011 through 2015, the revenue was close to $5,500. And after 2016 through 2020, we see that the revenue has been in the mid to high $7,500 range. And for the trailing 12 months, the revenue was about $8,000. Next is the operating income. This is the amount that's left with the company when it pays for all the cost of goods as well as the overhead expenses. And we can see that back in 2011, the operating income was $862, and it grew to $1,392 million for the trailing 12 months. So similar to the revenue, we can see that the operating income from 2011 through 2015 was plateauing, and then there was a jump in 2016, and since 2016, it has been plateauing in the $1,200 to $1,300 range. The operating margin is the ratio of operating income to the revenue. We can see that the operating margin ranges from a low of 14.6 to a high of 17.9%, and it has been in the mid to high teens range for the past decade. Next is the net income. Net income is the bottom line of the income statement, and this is the amount that is left with the company after it pays for all the costs, the expenses, the taxes, the interest on its obligations, and so forth. Back in 2011, the net income was $479 million. In 2018, it was $1,338 million. 2020, it was $780 million. And for the trailing 12 months, the net income is at $861 million. After that, looking at the dividends per share, back in 2011, Smucker's paid out a dividend of $1.64 per share. And every year for the past decade, Smucker's had a dividend hike. And for the trailing 12 months, we can see that the dividend payout was $3.52 per share. As far as the dividend payout goes, which is just a ratio of the dividend that's being paid out to the shareholders in comparison to the company's earnings, we can see that the ratio has never been greater than 100. And for the trailing 12 months, that ratio is 46.6%. So it looks like the dividend payout is sustainable for a longer period of time. Next, looking at the shares outstanding, back in 2011, Smucker's had 117 million shares outstanding. And it looks like for the next 5 years, up until 2015, Smucker's bought back some of its shares as the share count dropped to 103 million in 2015. After that, it might have done some equity financing, as we can see that in 2016, the shares outstanding jumped to 119 million. And for the past 3 years, since 2018, the shares outstanding have been steady at 113 million shares. Next is the book value per share. The way Morningstar calculates its book value is it's the difference of total assets and the total liabilities. In other words, the book value here is the shareholders' equity. We can see that the book value for Smucker's for the trailing 12 months is $73 per share. The $73.16 per share of book value is a little misleading, simply because we saw in the previous video that 75% of Smucker's total assets is goodwill and intangible assets. This means that if the company were to liquidate today, we do not know if those goodwill and intangible assets would actually be worth what it is worth on the company's balance sheet. So in the case of Smucker's, we should not be paying close attention to the book value per share. Next is the free cash flow. Free cash flow is the amount that we get when we subtract capital spending from the operating cash flow. We can see that the free cash flow for the past 10 years has always been positive. I will be using the past 10 years of free cash flows for my expected rate of return calculation. And I will be using the $1,169 million of free cash flow for the trailing 12 months for my discounted free cash flow DCF analysis. Now let's look at the working capital. Working capital is current assets minus current liabilities. And anytime we have a negative number, such as in 2017 and 2019, That means that at those times, the current liabilities that the company had exceeded the company's current assets. Ideally, for the working capital, we want the company to have a positive and a stable number. Next, let's focus on the profitability of the company, focusing on the net margin. Net margin is the ratio of the company's bottom line, which is its net income, to the company's top line, which is its revenue. So this number actually gives us an idea of how much of the company's sales actually gets translated to its bottom line income number. Smucker's net income for the past 10 years has been in the high single digit. Smucker's net margin for the trailing 12 months was 10.72%. So what this means is if Smucker's had a sales of $100, by the time it paid for all the costs, the expenses, the interest, the taxes, it had $10.72 left as net income. So it goes without saying that we want to see the net margin to be a big fat number. And as far as Smucker's goes, we can see that it has had a fairly stable net margin for the past 10 years. Next is the return on equity. This number gives us an idea of what kind of return can we expect on the investment that we make within the company. Warren Buffett likes the return on equity to be at least 8% or greater for a 10-year period or longer. For Smucker's, we can see that the return on equity has been greater than 8%, except in 2015 and 2019, when it was less than 8%. However, for the trailing 12 months, the return on equity is at 10.48%. After that, looking at the return on invested capital, this number gives us an idea of how good and efficient the management is at allocating and investing capital and getting a return on that investment. As we can see, back in 2011, the number was 8.18%. And for the trailing 12 months, it's at 7.18%. If we look at the trend, we can see that we had a couple dips in 2015 and 2019, similar to the return on equity. However, for the most part, the return on invested capital has been in the 6, 7, 8% range. And lastly, looking at the interest coverage, this number compares the company's interest obligations to its earnings. So for example, back in 2011, Smucker's interest coverage was 11.3. What this means is, given Smucker's 2011 earnings, it could have paid its interest obligations 11.3 times that year. Benjamin Graham states that one should only invest in companies that has an interest coverage of at least a 5.0 or higher. As we can see, Smucker's interest coverage has always been greater than 5, except in 2019 when it got to 4.37. However, for the trailing 12 months, the interest coverage is at 7.10. Next, looking at the financial health of the company, primarily focusing on the liquidity measures, the first one on the list is the current ratio. The current ratio compares the company's current assets to its current liabilities. Ideally, we want this number to be at least a 1.0. And a 1.0 simply means that the company has enough oxygen in its system to survive for another 12 months. As we can see for its 2020 reporting, the company had a current ratio of 1.24. However, for the latest quarter, the current ratio is at 0.96, which makes sense as we saw in the previous video where we talked about the seasonality and the working capital requirements that the company has for the first half of the year. Next is the financial leverage. We can see that for the past 10 years, the financial leverage has hovered between a low of 1.57 to a high of 2.38. And finally, looking at the debt to equity ratio, this ratio looks at the company's debt to its shareholders' equity. We want this number to be less than 1, even better if it's less than 0.5. Back in 2011, the debt to equity was at 0.25, and for the latest quarter, it's sitting at 0.57. So as far as the company's liquidity and the debt goes, it does not look too worrisome. After that, let's look at the efficiency ratios. First, looking at the day's inventory, we can see that back in 2011, Smucker's product sat in its inventory for about 91.55 days. And for the trailing 12 months, it's sitting in the inventory for about 74.55 days. So we can see that there has been a decline in the number of days that Smucker's product sits in the inventory, which is something we want to see in a company. Next, looking at the cash conversion cycle, this number gives us an idea of how long the company will be deprived of cash. And we can see that back in 2011, the number was 88.62. And for the trailing 12 months, it's at 49.07. So we can clearly see that there has been a decline over the years. Next, looking at the inventory turnover, which goes hand in hand with the day's inventory, the inventory turnover number gives us an idea of how many times does Smucker's inventory go through in a given year. And back in 2011, the number was 3.99. So Smucker's went through its inventory about 4 times a year in 2011. And for the trailing 12 months, it went through its inventory about 4.9 times. Now let's compare Smucker's valuation to the S&P 500. S&P 500 is simply the aggregate of the top 500 companies in the United States. For the current valuations, the first one on the list is price to earnings. We can see that Smucker's price to earnings is 15.3 as compared to the S&P 500, which is at about a 26. The price to book, Smucker's is at 1.6 as compared to S&P, which is at 3.6. The price to sales ratio for Smucker's is 1.6 as compared to the S&P 500, which is at 2.5. After that, looking at the price to cash flow, we can see that Smucker's is at 9.1 and the S&P 500 is at 14.9. And lastly, for the dividend yield, we can see that Smucker's is at 3.1% and the S&P 500 is at about 2%. So all these valuation metrics point out that J.M. Smucker Company is undervalued compared to the top 500 companies in the United States. Hey guys, now let's look at the discounted free cash flow DCF analysis for the company. Over here for my current year's free cash flow, I'm using $1,169 million. I got this number from the trailing 12-month figure for their free cash flow. I'm using my annual growth rate of 3%, a 10% discount rate, a 2% long-term growth rate. So the way this works is for the first 10 years, I'm assuming that my free cash flow will grow at 3%. And after that 10-year mark into perpetuity, I'm assuming that that growth will be at 2%. The numbers of shares outstanding is 113 million shares. The long-term debt is $5,373 million. I got this number from Smucker's balance sheet. And after taking all of this into account, I'm getting the intrinsic value to be about $90 per share. If we compare this intrinsic value to the current stock price of $115.5 per share, we can see that the current stock price is about 28% greater than the intrinsic value. And lastly, the way we calculate the intrinsic value is we look at what the free cash flows would be for the first 10 years. We sum all these free cash flows up. Then we look at what the cash flows would be from the 10-year mark into perpetuity. We add the cash flows from the first 10 years and then from 10-year mark into perpetuity up. And finally, we subtract the long-term debt and divide that number by the numbers of shares outstanding. And we get the intrinsic value of Smucker's to be about $90 per share. Hey guys, now let's look at the expected rate of return calculation. Over here, I pasted the past 10 years of free cash flow numbers that I got from Morningstar. As we can see in this graph, the free cash flow for the past 10 years has been trending upwards. Then we look at the future data and predictions. I'm assuming that there's a 25% likelihood that my free cash flow would grow at 5%, a 50% likelihood that the free cash flow will grow at 3%, and a 25% likelihood that the free cash flow will decline at 2%. Taking those future data and predictions into account, these are the future cash flow rates that we get. And lastly, taking into account the fact that we have 113 million shares outstanding, at the current stock price of $115.5 per share, we get the expected rate of return to be about 7.7%. This means that if we were to invest in Smucker's at the current stock price of $115.5 per share, we can expect to get a return of about 7.7% on that investment. Hey guys, now let's wrap it all up. We looked at various key ratios. We saw that the revenue as well as the net income for the past decade has been steady or increasing. We also looked at the net margin and saw that it was in high single digits. We saw that the return on equity was greater than 8% for 8 out of the past 10 years. We also saw that the return on invested capital was about 7% for 2020. We also reviewed Smucker's financial health. We looked at its current ratio, debt to equity ratio, financial leverage, as well as interest coverage, and realized that Smucker's debt is under control. We also noticed that the efficiency ratios for Smucker's had been improving for the most part for the past 10 years. After that, we compared Smucker's to the S&P 500 and saw that on all the valuation metrics, Smucker's was undervalued when compared to the S&P 500. Next, we performed the discounted free cash flow DCF analysis using a 10% discount rate and saw that the intrinsic value of this company was about $90 per share as compared to the current stock price of about $115.5 per share. We also saw that if we were to invest in Smucker's at the current valuation of $115.5 per share, we would get a return of about 7.7% on that investment. Finally, if we include the risk that we talked about last week, specifically the fact that Smucker's does not have a competitive advantage during times of recession when people would rather buy the cheaper private label product than pay for the branded Smucker's product, it does make us shy away from this investment if we are focusing on the near term. The other risk that is very concerning is that 75% of Smucker's total assets is goodwill and intangibles. This means that if there is an impairment in the goodwill, we clearly see the effect in the shareholders' equity section. For example, if the consumers do not prefer buying Folgers coffee anymore, and Smucker's thinks that the Folgers brand name is not creating the demand or creating the sales that it used to at one point, then it may say that, hey, its goodwill, its asset is impaired, and write it down. So the important question is, how do we evaluate a company that has 75% of its assets as goodwill and intangible? Because if you go to liquidate the company, we're not likely going to get 100% of that goodwill and intangible amount. So in times like this, I would fall back on The Intelligent Investor, where Benjamin Graham goes over two of the billion-dollar goodwill companies, as he calls it, and he talks about how you should go about looking at the company. And at the end, he asks us a question, and that's a question that we can ask with this investment. And the question that Ben Graham asks is, how many years of excellent future earnings would it take to realize that goodwill factor in the form of dividends or tangible assets? As of 2020, Smucker's goodwill and intangible assets totaled at $12,734 million. So if we divide the total goodwill and intangible assets of $12,734 million by the free cash flow of $986 million, we get about 13 years. So in answer to Ben Graham's question, it would take about 13 years for us to realize that goodwill factor of J.M. Smucker Company. In conclusion, we can say that J.M. Smucker's is a fair, financially stable, long-term investment. However, when we think about the opportunity costs involved with investing in this company, we realize that there are better opportunities that provide us a greater margin of safety, are undervalued, provide a greater return on our equity, as well as a greater return on investment in the future. And as you know, we have analyzed and covered some of those stock investments in our previous videos. Okay, guys, that is all I have for you this week. Hopefully you found this video helpful. Please do like, share, comment, and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.